Hey folks, it's Emily. I haven't given you an Earth systems update since November, which seems rude of me. But honestly, I didn't want to make one in February because some of the numbers were really coming in on the we're all going to die side of things. And I felt like we needed some March updates before I made an unnecessarily freaky outy type video. And I'm glad I waited because the new info coming in gives us some important context for what we saw in February of 25 when the Copernicus Institute reported a monthly average temp of 1.75 C over pre-industrial baseline globally. I thought that was very similar to what we had seen in late January to early February of 2024. Check it out. I saved this figure from the Copernicus Institute the last time it felt like we were all going to die, right in early 2024, where look, we had this huge temperature spike where for a couple of days we were over 2C. This spike is very like the similarly timed spike that we've seen this year in 2025. Because the 24 winter temperature spike went down, I didn't want to rule out that the 25 spike would do the same thing. And here, let's look at the recently released March of 25 Copernicus bulletin. In the highlighted information there, you can see that global temps have dropped and they're down to 1.59 C over pre-industrial baseline. And that's a similar drop to what we saw in 24 after the spike. Here's another figure I saved from last year, where here you can see this high point is that February spike. And then we saw a fairly steady decrease down to about a 1.5 C, which is still bad, but I'm going to take what we can get at this point. So we've got to keep watching the info as it comes in, but what we could have here potentially is evidence of a new pattern. And because, and let's say it again, there's not a strong consensus in the scientific community about what's going on in Earth's climate systems right now. There are many hypotheses to explain the level of global heat we've been experiencing since late spring of 23, but many important thinkers, including NASA's Gavin Schmidt, are encouraging us to keep an open mind that it does not appear we have a complete understanding of what is causing these observable changes to Earth's deep systems. And I'm starting to get the impression that the level of change is impacting our forecasting ability. For example, so this is NOAA's seasonal outlook issued in December, going January, February, March of 25, where they were showing pretty strong chances of above average precipitation across the Pacific Northwest and across parts of the Midwest. But if you check out the drought monitor, you can see that we're just not getting that rain. To be fair, the drought that we're seeing here in the Southwest, that is in line with NOAA's predictions. But we kept expecting precipitation with some relief to the drought up in the north, both in the Midwest and the Pacific Northwest, and it just hasn't come as anticipated. I do want to note that I'm recording this video on Wednesday, March 12th. If you look tomorrow, Thursday, the drought monitor may look different. Thursday is the day those updates drop. Overall, for a widely forecasted La Niña winter, this has been a very weak La Niña. And in the current ENSO update, you can see that we look to be leaving La Niña quite soon, which is unfortunate, as La Niña systems often have a bit of a cooling impact globally, and we really haven't gotten a good taste of that. I feel like it's important to keep an eye on this and see where things are getting kind of wobbly. My sense is that the pieces just aren't fitting together like they used to because the level of change in the underlying systems, as we can see with global surface air temperatures, which is what we're talking about when we talk about 1.5 C, 2 C, those numbers, and with sea surface temperatures. Let's take a look at those over on the good old climate reanalyzer. Here we are on the sea surface temperature page. You know, we lost incoming information for a while after Hurricane Helene whapped the NOAA Center in North Carolina. This is such an important source of incoming information. I just want to say a big thanks to any folks maintaining this site who might be watching. You all are awesome. When we look back, when we use this resource to look back in time, we can see it right here. We can see right here the moment where things got weird in late spring of 23. Look at the line. Let me move over a little bit so that you can see it better and see how these temperature anomalies just took off in late spring and early summer, as first seen in sea surface temperatures in the late spring and early summer of 2023. You can see what happened there with that line just has not normalized in 24 or so far in 25. As you can see on the visualization here, end of May is when I expect we'll be able to get more information related to potential pattern change. SSTs right now, you can see in the red, they're still running really high, but they're not the highest ever. And we have a pretty normal looking slope for this time of year. Like, check out the slope of the red line versus the slope of these historic mean lines. Very similar. Taking a minute to highlight the 2024 line, the slope then looked a little weirder, a little flatter to me. And I'm kind of wondering what's going to happen related to pattern repetition in the months to come as we focus in on sea surface temperatures. I'm curious to see if it's going to be more like that this year, where we have that longer, flatter line for sea surface temperatures, rather than those same curves that we've seen in measurements previous years in the ocean. Speaking of the ocean, let's take a minute to look at sea ice, because in the context of this weirdness, it may not shock you that there's also ice-related weirdness. So check it out. Here we are on Zach's beautiful page that visualizes incoming NOAA data, and we can see that Antarctic sea ice is very low, nearly a record low. And we continue to get a lot of information coming out of Antarctica regarding intense melt observations. And here we're looking at Arctic ice, which was doing relatively well for a while last year, and now it's really out there. We had seen Arctic ice nearly recover to a 2010s mean last year, so this record low we're seeing now is showing a very high rate of change and likely also indicates that the quality of the ice that is forming is not so good. That ice that was reforming was thin and weak. So we've got a delicate patient here as we're reading these signs. We got to do what we can to help life on Earth take up the work of healing. Refraining from active harm is not enough when a living system has taken this level of stress. These vital signs, to me, they show a loved one in continued distress. There are many worrying signs here. In terms of global surface temps, in terms of sea surface temps, we're not currently seeing an acute state of change. When we consider the signs from the ice, I think we should acknowledge that there is potential for system instability, though. So we're not currently seeing acute system change, as might have been suggested if we looked just at the February numbers, but acute system change could emerge. We should value this time with the Earth, and we should continue with a lens of healing, a lens of care, and consider this a critical time for intervention and patient care. I could have made a really scary video a month ago and then chosen to be curiously silent with this month's more normal information, with the signs that we're seeing of maybe some pattern formation this month. But it has to be said, I make a lot of not great decisions from a business perspective, including opting out of a recent offer from the platform here to increase my earning potential by making you all watch more ads. Sounds like they have a new AI thing where they try and give you ads right when they think you're most emotionally vulnerable because of modernity. But I promise, I will continue to make bad decisions in favor of your learning experience. What I care about is helping to grow our understanding. And ads are almost as bad for the learning experience as being unnecessarily freaked out. As I consider the months to come, I'm really wondering if we're going to see the same kind of global surface temperature pattern that we observed in 24 and the same kind of sea surface temperature pattern. If we're going to end up in even a semi-stable state for a while, that would be better than the alternative. At this point, we're going to take what we can get. So here's the deal. We're going to check back on these Earth systems in early June after the Copernicus Institute drops the May bulletin. Even if the incoming information is so bad I just want to hide under a blanket, I think that's the point where we'll have enough information, enough updates through these observation tools that we can look at some pattern implications. I sure hope all these observation tools stay up. So many people in this field are fellow Americans. Their jobs are at risk. We've already seen many firings at NOAA. Word on the street is we should be very concerned about our ability to get good info on hurricane trajectories this year. So you got to get your preps in place before disaster is the long and short of it, because we may not have as much warning as we're accustomed to prepare for weather-related disasters. And we know we're likely to be doing cleanup without a lot of federal assistance. Georgia and many other states have been requesting extended relief for the devastation of Hurricane Helene, impacting many agricultural areas in ways where we're going to continue to feel rolling effects, and the relief has been denied. There is a general message that we should be expecting states to have to take care of themselves. Thinking about doing cleanup from a disaster without federal assistance, I think that it's important to start thinking now about what kind of resources and connections we can build in our communities, how we can make our communities resilient against disaster from the ground up. I'm not saying it's right or wrong we should have to do that. I'm saying that looks like where we are. So as we're talking about incoming information, I just got to say, I'm so grateful we've got the Copernicus Institute. Because if we want to keep our fingers on the pulse of change, I feel like we've got hope we're going to be able to keep doing that, thanks to our friends in the EU. Let's keep an eye on incoming information so we can keep responding to change. It's time to get ready. Folks, thanks for watching. I always appreciate you spending some time with me. And I want to say a special thank you to the AR community, because you all are the people who are holding me up. When I need help, when I got questions, when I need an expert on just about any topic, this community is where I reach in. And I want to thank the community for supporting me so that I can do this work. AR doesn't run on grant money. I don't have some secret trust fund. AR runs on your donations. That makes us unique. And the way things are today, that makes us strong. I have many friends and colleagues who work in academic or government jobs, and they're all scared if they're going to be able to keep working. When I wake up, I'm grateful for you all every morning. I wake up and I know I can keep going thanks to this community. And every month, this community is a little bit stronger. We're strong in the way a people can be when we come together. You all are a force. The AR community is the force that is holding up a new way of talking about climate, a way that drives action, a way that brings people together. I want you to know we're hard at work on the ground launch. I'm doing some recording with a few of our volunteer leaders this week. I'm going to be bringing you some stories from them soon and showing you more about what we've got planned. I believe that people are ready to come together on climate, to respond to the changes we are seeing and feeling on the ground. This is an important moment to protect what we've got. Thank you for being here with me, and I'll look forward to talking with you all again soon.